Dr. Subi sir. Sir is working as assistant professor at the Department of Pharmacy Practice, Rama University of Applied Sciences, Bangalore. And sir has completed his master's from Sri Ramakrishna Institute of Paramedical Sciences, Coimbatore. And sir is pursuing his PhD at Rama University of Applied Sciences. Area of research of sir includes drug safety, signal detection, data mining, pharmacovigilance, and public health. And sir has been a part of 38 research products, published 32 papers in international journals, and 27 conference papers. And sir has received ACPE travel grant in 2018 China and 2019 Japan, ISPE Meteor Conference 2018 Canada and 2019 Rome. And sir is an active member of International Society for Pharmacology, International Society of Pharmacovigilance, ISTRI and ISPOR. With this brief introduction, I'd like to invite Subi sir to start the session.
Good morning all. Myself Subish, and thank you Dr. Saidi for introducing me. First of all, I should thank Viper Institute because the first time I visited in 2018, I guess, you know, I was just, you know, sitting somewhere there. In the course of 3 years, I'm here. So at that particular conference, I got the Best Poster Award, and that was the first inspiring thing happened in my life, and you know, that gave me a good platform and confidence to go further, because I was in a stage at that particular time, like, whether I was a little confused whether to pursue the same field or should I change it, because getting acceptance for a new thing, you know, as you know, it is quite challenging, isn't it? So Riper gave me that platform and gave me the confidence. So when Madam said that they invited for this talk, I was very excited, because you know, this is something which I should give back, because you give me the platform to start. And I can tell you, you know, it really flourished me, right? It made me where I am now. So, first of all, for that, I am, you know, very much thankful to all the, you know, Riper family. So, before starting, just a formal disclaimer, then yeah. So, just see this case. A 65-year-old male patient admitted in hospital with chief complaints of increased urine output, associated symptoms, and it's a non-case of type 2 diabetes mellitus. But he's having a good glycemic control. He's also hypertensive for the last 10 years. So, right now he's on NLRP2, which is an ACE inhibitor, cannabidiol, amlodipine. So, lab data shows that there is an increased level of creatinine and creatinine. So, doctor asked, you know, he's suspecting a drug associated problem here. What will be your observation for, in this case? Which drug might have caused increased creatinine level of creatinine? So, if you know, like AC inhibitor, they can decrease the creatinine clearance, isn't it? So, that is one drug which can possibly cause this particular problem. So, if you see the second case, a 60-year-old male patient, type 2 diabetic mellitus, dyslipidemia, hypertension, recently diagnosed with rhabdo. So, he is on linagliptin, insulin, atorvastatin, amlodipine, and NLRP3. Which drug will cause rhabdomyolysis?
Atorvastatin.
Third case, patient having dark color stool, abdominal pain. So they are expecting, I mean, they have, the first person have GI bleeding. He is on aspirin, clopidogrel, sinalcet, metoprolol, and insulin. So which drug? GI bleeding.
Aspirin.
Aspirin. most of you must have given these answers, right? But why you thinking it's only enalapril? Why not enalapril or amlodipine? Or why you thinking it's only atorvastatin? Why not linagliptin, insulin, and amlodipine? Why you thinking it's only aspirin? Why not other drugs? So for your information, enalapril recently got a new safety warning saying that it can cause kidney injury. So second, linagliptin got a new warning that it can cause rhabdo. Then cinacalcet, it got a new warning saying that it can cause JGD. So what I am trying to say is, if the drug is so safe, you know, whichever drug has come to the market, if they are very safe, then none of these drug tragedy might have happened, isn't it? So where it is going wrong? We have clinical trial, we have our pharmacology fellow to do our preclinical study, or even before that we have our simulation center and molecular docking to identify the efficacy of the receptor and the drug, correct? So everything done, then we come to the phase 1 trial, phase 2 trial, phase 3 trial, we cleared all of it and we are coming to the market. What is the difference the drug is facing when it's into the market and when in the clinical trial? What is the main difference between these two? If you are a automobile user, the car will be showing a mileage of 26 or 25 in the advertisement, but in the real practice, what we are getting, maybe 16 or 17. What is the difference? Or how they are claiming 26 there and we are getting 16? There will be a small sign saying that controlled environment, isn't it? The same thing is applicable in clinical trial. So in clinical trial, it's a controlled environment. We are mainly enrolling all the healthy volunteers, so only selected people, adult population, correct? And the variability, the heterogeneity of the population will be less. So let's take this particular classroom. Most of you must have from the same state at least, or maybe same district, maybe, correct? Only maybe V2 will be from the different state. So if you consider this particular population, the heterogeneity is comparatively less. But when a drug is marketed, they are not expecting that only a specific population will take the drug. Billions of people will be taking the drug. So let's assume, how much will be the population must have exposed during a clinical trial? Any idea? Put together, like phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, maximum of 10,000 people. Correct. Let's assume there is a reaction. That reaction might have happened only 1 in 20,000 people. Then, do you think it is possible to identify during the clinical trial? It's comparatively difficult. Correct. Okay, forget about that. Just assume 1 in 1 lakh or 1 in 10 lakh, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, right? All those things, it's quite difficult to identify in phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, correct? The reason is the population which is exposed, it is comparatively smaller. So there only the main important aspect of post-marketing surveillance is coming to the picture, correct? So what's happening in post-marketing surveillance? They're the actual population or the actual consumers of the drug or the actual target of the pharmaceutical industry, correct? They're the people who are going to use the drug, and there will be a huge heterogeneity. Everyone will be different, a person from Kerala will be taking the drug, Kashmir will be taking the drug, China will be taking the drug, Japan will be taking the drug, correct? Even Africa will be taking the drug. So their genetic variability is very high. So definitely their metabolism also will be different. Correct. I hope you must have studied all these things in your PKTDM. Correct. So they are different. Everyone is different. That's the importance of population pharmacokinetics. Correct. So all these things come to picture when it comes to post-marketing surveillance. Correct. So what will happen is, if you assume we identified all the reaction in our clinical trial, then all the drugs are safe. But that's not the actual thing. Correct. Most of the time we fail to identify many reactions. If I take an example, the bladder cancer associated with pyroglutasone, correct? Recently it got banned, not recently, 2013, I think, correct? Cardiovascular events, there are so many drugs which will remove from the market, again coming back to the market, all this circus will happen. Why is this happening? Because our clinical trial is not powerful enough to identify all the events. Then how to identify these events? Let's take a small example. So, you must have N4s to collect ADRs from the hospital, I hope. Correct. So what will happen if you have a target of, every month you have to collect 4 ADR, sometimes you book up the ADR, correct? Sometimes, some people. But how it is going to impact? that one report can actually make a difference in, you know, real world. You know, there's some frequency of an ADR. If the frequency of ADR is increased, that can change, that can even lead to a label change. So some, you may be thinking that, okay, only I'm doing this manipulation, but maybe like you, maybe 10,000 people are doing the manipulation, it can even go to a label change of the drug. You know, the drug will get a label change saying that this drug can cause this particular thing. So ADR reporting is a very important job, a responsible job we all should do. We should be proud to do that because no one else can do that, isn't it? Yeah. So let's assume a case, you know, a person was taking insulin and he is having hypoglycemia. So automatically what we will think, insulin is known to cause hypoglycemia. We will report to that particular drug also, isn't it? But in fact, the person was taking some other drug also, a new drug called X. We don't know anything about that X. So what automatically we'll do, we'll give only for insulin as a suspected drug. We'll omit this particular X. If you do so, what will happen? The X drug will be safe forever. Then how to identify whether X will cause hypoglycemia? If you fill that CVSE form, there is a column for filling concomitant drugs. Correct? So I reported that, you know, insulin causing hypoglycemia along with, you know, this particular X drug. You also reported, like around the world, there are so many people reporting the same thing. Even though our primary suspect is insulin, since X drug is common in all these reports, we can identify that. That's what? Data mining. Okay, so data mining is data mining. It is a knowledge discovery in a spontaneous reporting database. Okay? We'll go much into it. So how safe is a drug? If a drug has a market approval, do you think it is safe? Not at all. Correct? So these things we already discussed. How important is post-marketing surveillance? Because of the heterogeneity of the population, is very much important. Yeah. So usually a drug comes to the market, but after identifying the risk-benefit ratio, only if the benefit is more, we'll market that particular drug. Correct. But most of the time, what will happen is there will be a lot of unidentified or unreported events. So those things will be usually identified in the post-marketing surveillance. Then what is signal detection? Signal detection. So what is a signal? If I wave at you, it's a signal, right? I'm just communicating with you. Same like that, drug also giving a signal to you. There is something wrong, or there is something new. So what do you mean by signal? So WHO defined a signal as, I'll just read the definition, then we'll discuss about it. A reported information on a possible-causal relationship between an adverse event and a drug which the relationship is unknown or incompletely documented. So before that, let me explain what is adverse drug reaction and adverse drug event. Can you give an example of the difference between ADR and AE? Anyone?
ADR is bleeding due to aspirin usage.
ADR?
Usage of aspirin.
Mm-hmm.
ADE is dog,
either dog, bite, or cat, scratch. I'll come to that. See, I can tell you this way. In ADR, there will be a causal relationship. Citrosine, correct? This is a common example I will use. Citrosine will cause sedation. So the sedation is a ADR, adverse drug reaction. So after taking citrosine, the person drive and he met with an accident. So accident is a
event.
So this accident, it can happen because the person who comes opposite is also careless. Correct? Or while driving his trial, he lost control, accident. Or it can be because of his drowsiness. We don't know. So adverse event, it is difficult to make a causal relationship. But in case of ADR, yes, we can do. We can do a causal relationship. How? Your Nettinger scale or WHO scale. Correct? We can identify what is the relation between a drug and an event. Correct? Yeah. So what is a signal? So any signal is, a signal means a new thing. So paracetamol induced hepatotoxicity, it's not a signal, right? We know it. Correct. But paracetamol induced Q and Johnson syndrome, we never heard. So it's a signal. So you identify something new, which is not in the literature, which is not in the, I hope you are using micrometrics. Is that micrometrics access?
Lexicon?
Previously, you said. Now we are going to update.
Okay, Medscape. Correct. Medscape is a free level software which you can use. So if you search a particular drug in the portal, you will get all the ideas of that particular drug. Any reaction you are identifying apart from that list is a potential signal. Again, I am using the word potential. Why? I am not sure. Understood? If I am sure, I can say it is a signal. So if you are identifying something new, it is a potential signal. Correct? I hope you understood what is signal, what is area, what is adversity value. Is it clear? You want me to repeat? So mainly in this particular session, we will discuss what is a signal, what is signal detection, what we need to, why we do signal detection, then where we can find signal, then how to trigger a signal or what triggering a signal, then how to assess a signal. So these things we will discuss in this particular session. Yeah. So drug safety. What all things will come under drug safety, or how will identify the safety of a drug? You have different study designs, which you must have covered in your epidemiology. Correct? You have clinical trials to do, like RCT. Then you can do a case series. If you have, say, corona, COVID-19 infection, you can take series of cases, or you can follow one person with multiple time period. Anything, any of these things you can do. But make sure that you have more than 3 cases. Then it will come as a case series. Then observational studies, where you are not doing an intervention, you are just observing what is happening. That is also one way of identifying safety of a drug. Then you have case control study, mainly retrospective nature. You have a case, you have a control. The only difference between these two populations will be the exposure, drug exposure. Correct? Then you have case reports, single case reports. I think you must have doing it for your publication. Okay, so usually in a conventional way, how the signal is generated. So this is mainly from a pharmaceutical industry perspective. Okay. So usually, so there is a patient exposure, and you have a single suspicious case or a cluster. Yeah. So what do you mean by single suspicious case? Let's take an example of paracetamol and. Please come on. Paracetamol and stimulant. Okay, that will be one case or a collection of 3 or 4 cases. So that is known as a cluster of cases. So it can be a signal, a potential signal. Okay, so what we do, we'll perform any of the statistical analysis to confirm that it is a potential signal, or what you say, it is a disproportionality analysis. We'll come to that. Then what we do, we integrate more information to that. This particular step is known as refining the signal. Integrating more means, see how we can correlate paracetamol with Stevens-Johnson syndrome. So what we do, we know how Stevens-Johnson syndrome will happen. So we will see whether any of the paracetamol metabolite can trigger this particular event. Correct. So like that, we will try to make a causal relationship between the drug and the event. That is known as refining. And if we could able to identify this particular event is associated and it is potentially disabling, or the outcome is death, then what we will do? We will have an action. What type of action? It can be a label change, it can be a drug withdrawal from the market, it can be limited to a particular population. Example, nimesulide. Nimesulide is only used in case of adult. Correct? It is not used in pediatrics because it causes liver injury. So we can restrict to that category also. This is the conventional way. Okay, let's speak about data mining that we are discussing. It is a knowledge discovery process. Then, it is a systematic examination of reported adverse event. So let me speak a little bit about your CDSCO reporting. I hope you must be reporting your ADR. So there will be a zonal center where you will be giving your reports to the zonal center. Zonal center will give to the PVPI. Correct. So PVPI will collect all the information from around everywhere from India, then they will refine the particular report. Whichever report is valid, whichever report has complete information, they will give to Uppsala Monitoring Center, which is in Sweden. Okay, so Uppsala Monitoring Center will be getting this information from around the world. So not only from India, right? I think more than 150 countries, they will be sending their adverse drug reaction to Uppsala Monitoring Center. Uppsala Monitoring Center, again, they will refine the data what they are getting. Then those reports will send to FDA. Understood. So a report what you are doing, sending from here, it will reach to US, free of cost. So what will happen? FDA will be getting all the information from Uppsala Monitoring Center along with all the adverse reactions have been used. Understood. So this is a usual process. So if you think the database what FDA has, it is more than 50 crores of reports. Okay. So that is the quantum, or that is the amount of data we are going to handle in FDA database. It is freely available to everyone. Okay. So that is the database we are going to explore today. Please imagine the quantum of data. How much is your sample size for your 50th study? For my master's, I did my study for 120 people. Where is 120, where is 50 crore? Understood? So what will happen when you increase your sample size, your alpha and beta will be reduced. Okay. So automatically you will have more refined this study. So here the signals, we are discussing about signals, right? So the signals will be generated as a mathematical score or a value. This value will tell you how much your drug and the event is associated. Let's take the same example of paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. So if I'm saying that my signal of Stevens-Johnson syndrome and paracetamol is 5, which means that paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome, 5 times they are associated with compared to the other drugs. Understood? So that is the meaning of signal. You know how much it is related. Then, the signal detection technique or data mining can be used for two purposes. One is identification of a new adverse event we were just discussing, or inappropriate use of a drug. Okay, a new indication also we can identify. Example, minoxidil. I studied minoxidil as an antihypertensive, but now it is not antihypertensive. What is it used for? Adderall. Correct. One more thing, minoxidil that time it was costing some 2 rupees or 3 rupees. Now, some 500 rupees for small bottles. Correct. So I think hypertension is okay, but not effort. They are ready to spend more money for effort. So how this data mining changed the industrial perspective regarding signal detection? You see, they incorporate the traditional method. They are not leaving it at behind. Along with that, they give data mining also. They incorporate both. Then they will get the signal. Then they will generate a hypothesis. Then we verify or refute the signal what we generated. Then they will identify whether it is a type A, type B reaction. Then they will remove the outliers, estimate the incidence. Then we will take an action depending upon the severity of the particular signal. So any doubt till now? Is it clear? This is like a random arrangement of some letters, isn't it? See, for us, 50 crore report will be like this. Manually we cannot identify any pattern here. But you see, this is a particular pattern is repeating. Correct? This is not a trend analysis. Okay, to identify any trend in a database. So that is what this technique only we are going to use in case of signal detection. You have a huge data collection. In that you are trying to identify any disproportionality, that means which is something which is abnormal. If you can see, my name also in there. But previously it was not visible, right? Correct. So we are trying to identify which is something hidden in a database. Okay. So that is known as data mining. Data mining is knowledge discovery in a database. Okay, why we should do signal detection? To identify rare adverse events. So I told you, if the particular event is say 1 in 20 lakhs or 1 in 1 lakh, it is impossible to identify during the clinical trial. So in those conditions, you will be completely depending on data mining or post-marketing surveillance. Understood? So that is important. You see a few examples. Association of asthma therapy and Chancellor syndrome. This particular event will happen 1 in 10 lakhs. How rare it is. Is it possible to identify this kind of thing in a normal setting? Just assume, I given you as a, you are family work. You are going to hospital, you are going to collect at least 20 lakhs cases to get 2 cases of this particular event. Correct. It's practically impossible to do a cohort study. Correct. So there are only all these kind of studies we can use our database. Then serum sickness like reaction for cephalothorax. T-cell non-Hodgkin lymphoma reported for adverse reaction with TNF-alpha inhibitor. Then association between leukotriene modifying agent and suicide. Then drug induced injury or overdose. All these things are very rare, quite difficult to identify. But when you know, depending on your database, since we have a huge data, we can identify all these rare events also. Okay, so I keep saying disproportionality. What do you mean by disproportionality? So if it is a single case, let's say hyperglycemia and insulin, you can do causality assessment with your Nyringer scale or your WHO scale. Okay. What if I have 50 cases? Okay, you put a hard work and the day and night you can complete the analysis. What if it is 500? What if it is 5,000? What if it is 1 lakh? As the data increases, you know, the power of our capability to, you know, solve that particular thing will be difficult. So in that case, you cannot completely depend on causality assessment. We have to find something, you know, which is more advanced, which won't replace completely this causality assessment. But at least you can replace it. Not completely, but yeah. As a screening tool, we can use. Okay, so that is known as disproportionality analysis. So what is disproportionality analysis really? So I was speaking about paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Is it happened by chance? You know, only that person is going to happen. Or it's just a mere coincidence. We don't know. Right? That we can identify with the disproportionality analysis. Or sometimes what will happen is, you know, the paracetamol might be completely innocent. You know, it might be because of some other drug which is given with paracetamol. Possibility is there, isn't it? So how to identify these things? That only is good. Yeah, this is quite interesting. This particular thing, this concept I taken from Uppsala Monitoring Center short courses. Okay, so these things are available in their website, free of cost. There are short courses you can join and you can enroll. End of the day, you will get a certificate also from WHO. Okay, UMC short courses you can use. Yeah, so let's speak about two tiger in a zoo. Is this 2 tiger, that number 2, is it a big number? No, we can expect 2 tiger in a zoo, that's quite common. What about 2 tiger in a road? It's not common, right? Okay. 5 girls in a classroom. Yeah, we can expect 5 girls in a classroom. But what about 5 girls in a boys only classroom? That's not expected, isn't it? The same way, same concept. You have 5 reports of what? 5 reports of Y reaction for X. So let me ask you, this 5 reaction is a big number? Answer should be depends. Correct. Depends on what? Depends on the situation. Correct. Whether we don't know whether the lion or the tiger is in the road or in the zoo. We don't know the girls are in the boys only classroom or the common classroom. Correct. Depend on the situation, the number will change. So depends on what? Here, how many people took the drug? That actually matters. Isn't it? Let's say 5 people took the drug, 5 of them got ADR. Then 5 is a big number. Say 10,000 people took the drug, only 5 of them got event. We cannot say 5 is a small number if 5 of them dead. Assume just 5 of those had ADR and those 5 dead. In that case, this 5 is not a small number. Let's assume this reaction is a common cold or a cough. Then 5 becomes small number. Correct? So practically, you know, it is impossible to calculate these numbers. How many people took the drug? Correct? Because we are going to deal with the data of all around the world. Not only from one space, I mean, a school or a college or a hospital. It's from 150 or more than 150 countries. So how will we get to know how many people consume the drug and how many people go out the area? Correct. It's impossible. Then what will we do? Yeah. So there only this disproportionality analysis comes into picture. The idea of disproportionality is to use a database of spontaneous report itself to compute the number you would expect if the drug had even occurred by chance. What I'm trying to say is, let's assume this particular event happened by chance, or let's assume there is an association and we have an expectation, and if the observation is beyond the expectation, then we will call it as a disproportionality.
when I said a zoo, all of you said that two tiger in a zoo is quite a common number. Because why are you saying that? Because you have an expectation, a priori, right? That's the term they use in statistics, a priori. You have an expectation. Then, what is your observation? Two tigers in a zoo. That is your observation. What is your expectation? Your expectation will be 30 tigers in a zoo. Correct? Then, out of that 30, this 2 is small. So, what you are basically doing, you have an expectation. You are comparing that expectation with an observation. Correct? The same way, we have a database. In the database, we will find what is the expected frequency of an area. So, let's take the same example, Stewart-Johnson syndrome. So what we'll do, we'll calculate how much of the Stewart-Johnson syndrome is there in the database. Let's say the total database has 100 reports. In that 100 reports, I have 5 cases of Stewart-Johnson syndrome. Then what is the reporting rate of Stewart-Johnson syndrome? You can say 5 divided by 100. Correct, 5%. So if I'm taking 10 reports randomly, 10 reports from the database, in the 10 reports, 5% of the 10 should be Stewart-Johnson syndrome. Correct? If you have more than that, it is disproportionate. Are you getting this concept? Yes or no? No. We'll give come with an example. Okay. Maybe you can use your pen and pencil to answer this, solve this. Simple calculation. We are basically trying to fill this particular table. Okay. So you have graph here, you have all the other terms. You have your adverse reaction here, all the other adverse reaction. Fine? Yeah. So what is the graph? See, we have 45 people in this room, assume. 10 of them ate cake. In that, 2 of them got regurgitation. Okay. Another 7 who didn't eat cake also got regurgitation. So this is the situation. How will you put into this particular 2x2 table? The same thing what you use for your odds ratio, I think. Right? How will you put into it? So let's say, how many of them took the drug? 10 of them ate the drug. So here it will be 10. Please, 10. How many of them got regurgitation?
Two.
Where are they by two?
A.
A, E and R. Yes. Correct. Two of them got regurgitation. I also mentioned 7 who didn't eat cake got regurgitation. So where that 7 will come? Other. Total?
9.
45, right? No, here. Total population is
45.
Any fill this table? 7 plus 2?
9.
Here? 8. Difference? 35. Right. Yeah, total 45. 10 is here, so remaining is 35. So the difference between these two will be? 28. Difference between these two will be? 36. That's all. So, like this, we are identifying, or we are first, the first process in a simple detection is creating this 2x2 table. Understood? So, if you know how to do it, then job is done. How many of you are clear with this concept? Any doubt? So, I have one more example, like simple process and epidemiological process. I think you can skip it. I hope all of you are comfortable with this calculation. See, please listen, this is little confusing. And even if you didn't understand, we have a direct formula to answer it. Okay, this is to make you understand how the signal detection works. Okay, yeah. So, this case is ciprofloxacin and epidermolysis bullosa. So, we have how many total 1000 reports are there in that particular database. Correct. So in that 1000, what is the expected rate of EB? Rate reporting of EB. So how much EB is there? EB means EE total, AE total. 9. There are 9 reports of epidermolysis bullosa in that particular database. Correct? 9 out of 1000. So what is the reporting rate? 9 by 1000. Will be how much? 0.9. Agree with me? Yeah. So, can I tell, if I randomly take 100 report, in that 100 report, 9 epidermolysis bullosa will be there? That means 0.9%. Correct. Not 9. Okay, 0.9. Not 0.9 also. 0.09. Correct. If I take 100 reports randomly from this database, in that 100 report, 0.9% will be epidermolysis bullosa. Correct. That is what our expectation. Okay. Let's take about ciprofloxacin. Expected rate of EB with ciprofloxacin. So how many ciprofloxacin cases we have? We have 26 cases of ciprofloxacin. Correct. So how much cases you will expect? What is the expected frequency of ciprofloxacin associated epidermolysis bullosa? 26 into 0.9. Okay? You said if it is 100, 100 into 0.9. So if it is 26, then what is the expected frequency of EB associated with ciprofloxacin? Into 0.9. That is 26 into 0.9. Why are they doing this 0.9? That is the frequency of EB. You take any random cases from the database.
Expected.
In that 0.9 will be the expected frequency. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes.
So 26 into 0.9, you will get 0.23. Okay, so this is what your expectation. But surprisingly, what is observation? You have 3 cases. Correct. So, what do we do? Observed divided by expected. That means 3 divided by 0.2. You have 12.8. What that number indicate? Says that for ciprofloxacin, 12 times it is having more risk to cause epidermolysis bullosa with respect to other drug. Is it clear? You want me to repeat? Yes. Okay. So I'll repeat again. See, we have 1000 reports in that database. Okay. In that 1000 reports, 9 is epidermolysis bullosa. Then what is the reporting rate? 9 divided by 1000. How much it is? 0.9. Correct. So if I take any cases randomly from this database, how much ever number I am taking, in that number, 0.9% is supposed to be EB. That is what my expectation. Or that is what my a priori information from the database. Correct. So, I got 26 cases of ciprofloxacin. So, with respect to my expectation, in that 26 cases, 0.9 should be EB. So what I am calculating? I am calculating the expected frequency of EB associated with ciprofloxacin. How much it is?
0.23.
0.23. Correct. Then I just divided observed versus expected. Your chi square test. Right. Chi square test, we are doing this only. What do you get? We get 12.8. Which means that your expected and observed, there is a difference of 12. Or in other words, ciprofloxacin has 12 times more risk of causing EB compared to the other drug in the database. Clear? Does it clear? Okay. So this is known as relative reporting ratio. Relative reporting ratio. You're relating it. Right? Next is proportional reporting ratio. Okay. Proportional reporting ratio, I think there's a scientist called Evans. He discovered this particular process, which made a lot of argument in the how you will fight with your friends like that. They had a huge fight in the literature in 2003. We'll come to that. So here what is happening is, the way they calculate in PRR is different. See, you calculate the expected frequency, right? Here what we do is, We won't consider the drug exposed population. What Evans believe is, see, this 26 case. In this 26 case, there is a disproportionality. Correct? Then let's not take the calculation for your expected frequency. So what we'll do, we will remove this particular number from your calculation and we will redo the calculation. So expected frequency will be, instead of 9, we will take 6. Why? Because we don't know whether this 3 is proper or not. 3 is proportional or disproportional. So we will remove this 3. So 6 divided by 690. So we will get 0.61. Expected also, 26 into 0.61, you will get 0.16. Observed is 3, we will be getting almost 18. Okay, this is another algorithm to identify the signal. So you must have asked me, sir, last time you got 12, this time it is 18. You know, then how it is related? You know, if two algorithms is giving you two answers, you know, how it is possible to do? But most of the time, they all lead to the same direction. What I am trying to say is, we are handling the data of 1000, where the database will have a, you know, having a huge data. So this kind of, you know, difference won't be there. Okay, mostly you will get similar result for your PRR and this is PRR and the other one, RRR. Okay, another one is reporting odds ratio. This is similar to your odds ratio. The only difference is, in odds ratio you use, which study design? Case control. So, what is case control? You have a case, you have a control. The only difference between these two populations is, in your control, there won't be any drug exposure. So, meaning everything should be safe. But what about our database? It's not like that. Every case having some or other drug exposure. Correct? So, instead of calling it as a case control, we will name it as case non-case analysis. I'll repeat. This case non-case analysis. Okay, it's not a case control. It has all the characteristics of a case control, but we don't have a control. Instead of control, we use non-case. That means, case means the drug of interest what we have. Non-case means all the other drugs. Clear? So we will name this odds ratio, or we will rename this odds ratio into reporting odds ratio. Formula remains the same. Any doubt till now? Are you clear with these three algorithms? But you know, luckily, you don't have to remember any of these things. Okay. If you understand the concept, you will understand what is the meaning of that particular result. But manually, you are not going to do any of these things. You type, you click, computer will give you the answer. Okay. So you must have studied this chi-square calculation, t-test calculation, paired t-test calculation, your statistics. But in SPSS, if you give all the data, that will give you the answer. Same way, here also, you don't have to calculate anything manually. You give the data, you feed the data, computer will give you the answer. Okay? So, yeah, see this particular square, that is the total population. In the total population, see the first circle. That is the amount of people took the drug. Correct? In that, see the second circle. That is the people who had occurred ADR. Third circle, ADR reported to the database. What happened here? We lost some data here because of the reporting. Right? Not all the ADR will be reported, isn't it? Because of that, we lost some data. So, in this, what is A? A is a point where our drug of interest and event of interest will be there. Correct? Which means your paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome together happening. That is this point, A. B is the reports of paracetamol. C is the reports of Stevens-Johnson syndrome. D is the database. Clear? Yeah. How many finite probabilities? So one of the things we discussed till now is frequency method. Okay, there is something called Bayesian method, which is quite confusing. And luckily now, in many of the studies are not using Bayesian method. But I just want to tell you how it is hypothetical. So, here we are identifying the probability of occurrence of reporting your drug of interest and event of interest. So, the probability of reporting drug of interest and event of interest together. What that mean? When it happened together only, they'll report together. Correct? So you identify the probability of two events to happen together. What are the two events? Your drug of interest and your event of interest. So that's how you will calculate IC value. IC means information component. This is a Bayesian method. So these are the formula again, I just compared everything like that. Okay, so I was discussing about one debate which happened in the literature, right? The debate was with Ruth Ford and Evans. So Evans is the person who introduced proportional reporting ratio. And Ruth Ford is the person who was supporting reporting odds ratio. So it's something like, you know, the fight that happened between, two leading companies. How they will fight? The same way. You know, the best example is BMW and Benz. You must have seen that advertisement, right? They will join each other. The same way, you know, they were having a fight in the literature. So what Ruth Ford was stating is, you know, this ROR is, sorry, PRR is nonsense. Because what will happen if, so you should understand how the PRR is calculated. PRR means A divided by A plus C. All divided by B divided by B plus T. That is the formula. So what basically we are trying to see? Reporting of an event compared to all the events of that particular event. That means, what is the percentage of Steven Johnson syndrome? For assume that there is 3 reactions of Steven Johnson syndrome. And total paracetamol we have 10. So 3 by 10. All divided by, in the whole database, you have a Steven Johnson syndrome of 10. Divided by all the other events, that is some 10,000, and you are finding the ratio. So here the problem is, you know, assume a particular drug, let's say, I think I kept your example. Yeah. For example, UITs and rifabutin. So 75% of the report for this drug for one reaction. So rifabutin. 75% of them were for one reaction. So what will happen is, for all the other reaction of rifabutin, you won't get a signal. Even if it's significant, it will be diluted. That is the problem with the calculation. You know, should it say fault in the calculation? We can't help it. So that was the point which Ruth Ford was putting forward, saying that, you know, you cannot use PRR because it will mask many of the important adverse events. So the Evans, who discovered PRR, what he said is, so if you see PRR, how it is calculating, sorry, yeah, ROR, A by B divided by C by D. So which is basically come to one formula, which is A by D divided by B by C, which is cross multiply that. Correct. Let's assume either B or C is zero. That means, let's assume there is no drug is causing Steven Johnson syndrome, only paracetamol is causing Steven Johnson syndrome. Then you cannot use ROR. Correct? Because the denominator will be zero, which you cannot calculate. So, what Evans was telling is, you should use both. You cannot depend on ROR, you cannot depend on PRR. Both are based on fault and advantage. So, use it together. So, that's what we follow. Okay, so what I'm addressing is, what I'm trying to say is, whenever you are doing a signal detection technique, you should not depend on one particular algorithm. Use both. Anyway, everything is depending upon that 4x4 table. And anyway, you are not going to do anything calculation. You just click on the ROR, computer will calculate ROR. You click on PRR, computer will calculate and give you PRR. Understood? So the database, I think madam will cover that portion. I am not touching that. Yeah, what are the databases we are discussing? So my work mainly focusing on the first two databases. First is FDA AERS database. Second is Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting System. Both are belongs to FDA. Okay, it is freely available. You don't have to pay anything. You can freely download. Only thing, you should have a skill set to analyze it. This is what I sent a mail to the FDA asking for the permission. They said you don't have to take any special permission, it is publicly available. Okay. So if someone asks you, who gives you the permission to use FDA database, you say FDA only gives the permission. This freely available, anyone can use. So how you select a drug given combination and where you get the information? So I was telling you paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Where you will get this information? How much time it will take to do one study? Right. These things are very much matters when come to the student's perspective or a PhD student's perspective. Right. We have time frame. Before that, you have to finish. We'll answer that. It will vary depending upon the study objective. There are studies which we finished within hours. There are studies which is still going on, like my PhD. You know, it's been, we are doing it for the last 5 years and we are almost in the end of the process. So it depends on the objective what you are selecting. Okay, so if you are in a tight time frame, then maybe you can select a small study. If you have time, you have patience, go ahead with a study. I'll tell you how to calculate, how to select the study designs also. So what are the resources? Where will you get this question? See, most of the time you will get this question from hospital itself. So I'll give you an example. We had a case of osteonecrosis of jaw associated with the use of letrozole. So one case which we observed in the hospital. But when we checked, there are few case reports. Then we analyzed more about that particular thing. We got a good publication out of it from this. So that particular research question I got from hospital. So a good observation during your ward rounds is very important for this. Next, articles. At least you should enroll for table content, correct? Every journal monthly they will send you the content of the particular journal. No, you don't have to read everything. You read the title. It is free of cost. They will send you to your mail. So read it. You will get some ideas. You will get new ideas. Okay, so that is another source what I use. Case reports. There are many journals which is publishing only case reports. Read those case reports. That can be used for your signal detection. Can be feed for your signal detection technique. Textbook, no, don't read all textbook. The recent advanced, latest textbook you read, there also is a good source of information. They will be telling the information with respect to this area is yet to identify. That is your duty to identify. Okay, that also you can see. These are the few suggestions for journals which you can find all these case reports. You can just go through it. Most of them are open access. You will get the full text. How to confirm? No, first, definitely you have to search in Micromedics or Medscape. Then FDA safety signal, you just Google it, you will get FDA safety signal, you Google. So assume you selected paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. First you have to do is check either Medscape or Micromedics or Lexicon and check for whether it is non or not. If it is not, then there is no point of going further. You know, that is over. You have to identify a new drug event combination. If it is not known, then next is you have to check for FDA safety signals. If it is there, again, end of story, you have to go back and find a new one. Then, you have to check in NCBA, the PubMed and Science Direct. You have to see whether anyone already did the study. Same like this, there will be people who are doing this study, isn't it? So, you should identify whether it is already covered or not. Then, DailyMed, this is a very important thing. DailyMed will give you the full information about post-marketing surveillance and the clinical trial. So DailyMed, especially section 5 and 6, 6.2. Okay, so there also you have to check, make sure that the signal what you identify is normal. Then last, ask Google. Sometimes what will happen is you won't get all information from PubMed and Science Direct. So ask Google. Before you start, you have to make sure that it has a signal. I was telling paracetamol and Stevens-Johnson syndrome. That doesn't mean that it will have a signal. So, madam will teach you how to calculate or how to identify. I told you, just one click you will get the signal. So, that next session, madam will teach you. So, prerequisite before starting. All these things you can get. What you need is patience. So, we have two students. One is smart, other is hardworking. What happened is, the person who is hardworking, it took a really long time to identify a particular drug research question. Only because she was not lucky enough. Whatever she was selecting, one or other way we will get stuck. Either it will be there in DailyMed or we cannot go further, then we will remove. Then we will take the next drug. we'll identify. We'll reach almost to the end. We'll identify it is already published. We'll remove. We'll take the next one. But the other person who took the, you know, he from the first drug what he selected only, he got it. Understood. So it's again sometimes luck. You know, sometimes what you can say, the extent you are searching. You know, if you search all these things and you identify that particular event is novel, then you are lucky enough, you can go ahead. Yeah, let's do it. That madam.
Okay.
Any questions? Yeah, any questions? If you have any questions, any clarification, you please ask me. Any doubts? Happy to answer. Anything? You understood?
Understood.
Yeah?
Yes.
If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Anyway, come here. You see. Thank you.